Thanks, Avi. Yeah, so this is a talk about polynomial bounds for the grade minus theorem, and this is joint work with Chandra Chakuri. So a few words on background. Grade minus theorem also goes under the name of excluded grade theorem, and it came out of the work of Robertson and Seymour on graph minus theory. So this is very deep and fundamental work in graph theory that spans more than 20 papers and took many years to complete. And one of the main goals of this work was to prove what was known as Wagner's conjecture, that says that if we have any infinite sequence of graphs, and all the graphs are going to be finite here, then there are two graphs where one is a minor of another. I'm going to explain these terms. And the grid minor theorem itself says that if your graph has a large two width, then it has a large grid minor. Again, I'm going to explain these things. So this theorem, it plays an important role in this whole graph minus series. And it's a very useful theorem, so it has found many applications in different areas, as we will see. So let me start by explaining what a two-width is. And I will start with some intuition. And the intuition is quite simple. The intuition is that trees are good for us. Trees are those really simple graphs on which we often have really good algorithms, while maybe on general graphs, so for some problems, you have good algorithms on trees, but not on general graphs. Or maybe you can get really good approximation on trees, but not on general graphs. But now what happens if your graph is, you feel it's simple. You feel it's maybe close to being a tree. Maybe it's a tree and a couple of edges, right? You want to be able to exploit the machinery that exists for trees on such graphs. So two-width does it. First of all, it measures, it's like a way to measure how close your graph is to being a tree. And second, it gives us the machinery, it gives us the tools that will help us exploit what is known for algorithms that run on trees. And like also one of the main intuitions why trees are so good for us is because very easy to run dynamic programming algorithms on trees. Because whenever you take one vertex out of a tree, you split it into several subtrees that are totally disjoint, they don't interact with each other. And this helps you in building dynamic programming algorithms. So let's now formally define what a two-width. So we take just any graph. And in order to define two-widths, we think about this as if we simulate this graph on some tree. So we take some tree. And for every vertex of this tree, we put a bag on it. Now into this bag, you're allowed to put any vertices of this graph and any edges of the graph that you want. And you know, this may be a bag associated with this vertex. You can put the same vertex into several bags, the same edge into several bags, whatever you want. So you put these bags on each one of these vertices of the tree. And now there are two things that have to happen. First, if you look at any edge of your graph, there must be at least one bag that contains it, that pink bag. And two, if you look at any vertex of your graph, and you look at the bags that contain this vertex, they have to form a connected subtree of your tree. So if you put A here and you put A here, you have to put it also here. So this makes a valid tree decomposition. Now, given a valid tree decomposition, the width of this decomposition, you just look at the largest number of vertices in any bag, minus one. Now, this minus one may look a little silly, but it's there to ensure that the two-width of a tree is one. It's like a normalizing thing. And finally, the two-width of a graph is the smallest width of any decomposition. So the width of this decomposition is two because we have at most three vertices in any bag. So now if we look, if our graph has small two-widths, it does behave as a tree in some way because if you decide to take out, for example, this vertex, which means taking out all vertices in this bag, then things that are below and things that, you know, the rest of the graph, they don't interact. There is nothing in common. So again, you can take out a small number of vertices and you can decompose your graph. And because of this, you can still use all these dynamic programming algorithms. But if the two-width is large, then if you look at any one of these bags, it can be just as complex as the whole graph. It can be really large. And so this doesn't really help you to have this tree decomposition.
Another definition, like we have a definition of three-width, what you are allowed to do recursively to your graph is remove, let's say you want three-width k, you are allowed to remove any k vertices, and from whatever pieces are left, you are recursively.
Not completely, because you take out these k vertices, and you want them to be kind of like an interface for your next cut, right? So you want to a sparse cut with respect to these vertices. Yeah, this is how you.
They will repeat, but it's a recurrent.
It's the way to build. I will actually say something also, a different definition of trivets. So here are some typical numbers just to give you a sense. A trivet of a tree is 1. A trivet of a cycle is 2. If you take root n by root n grid, the trivet is root n. If you take an n-vertex expander with constant degree, then the trivet is roughly n. So this was the standard definition of trivets. Now I want to define another notion that is very helpful for us and which is closely related to trivets. Actually, you can think about this notion as a different way of defining trivets. And this notion is going to be Wawrinkiness. So let's look at our graph G. And let's say that these red vertices are a subset of vertices of our graph. They're not all the vertices. And I want to define what it means for these vertices to be well linked in my graph. So I want them to be really well connected in this graph. For example, if I take two equal size subsets of these vertices, I want to be able to connect every vertex on the left to every vertex on the right by these joint paths. So it's important here, I'm not asking about a specific matching. I don't say this has to go here, this has to go here, this has to go here. This is not the case. All I want is that every vertex on the left is connected to some vertex on the right and vice versa by this joint path. That's all I'm asking. So this is like an max flow thing. So if I can do it for every single choice of these two equal size disjoint subsets of these red vertices, then I say that the set of red vertices is well linked in my graph.
So it's like the definition of superconcentrator, only there you have inputs and outputs.
Like in the definition of?
Superconcentrator.
It's basically, you can also think about it as a sparsest cut, non-uniform sparsest cut, yes, in the vertex cut version, yeah. Yeah, you can view it in many different ways. Okay, so it's a really strong requirement of connectivity. It says no matter how you take two equal size subsets, you can always connect them by disjoint paths. And there is this really maybe surprising but very useful connection that if you take the largest set of vertices in your graph, which is well linked, then the size of this subset is going to be the same as trivets to within factor 4. So you can think of this as a different way to define trivets. And this is very useful, and it really played the central role in the proof of this theorem, in our proof.
It says AD can be of
any size? Yes. For any, yeah, just any two subsets, they have to be of equal size. It's not important.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is complicated.
This, so there is a proof that goes through Brambles, which is not hard, but you need to know Brambles. No, so what you can do is just start building, like you said, start computing balanced cuts or sparsest cuts. And when you're stuck, you can show that from this set, you can build a large walling set. You can do that. OK. So what we said so far, just to. One of these directions. I mean, if you know Brambles, it's pretty elementary. But I don't want to define Brambles. Give me a sec. Yeah, I'm. Maybe I'll think of this offline. Okay, so going back to this big picture, so we know that trees are very good for us. And we said small tree with graphs, maybe not as good as trees, but still pretty good. But what if a graph has a large trivet? Then, you know, too bad. This tree decomposition does not help us. Still, it would be really neat to have something very useful to say about such graphs. We want some kind of a hammer, a generic hammer, that will let us handle graphs that have large trivets. In this case, small trivets will treat like trees, and large trivets will gonna do something else. And this grid minor theorem is exactly this large hammer. It tells us that if the trivet of G is large, then G contains a large grid minor. Yeah, so maybe I was going to say a few more words of intuition. So what would be this good thing that we want to say? And the idea is going to be to kind of look at the glass half full. So we said we don't like these guys because they're far from being trees. They're not so simple. Now you want to say, OK, these graphs, they're not simple. They have really rich, interesting structure. And now we want to explore this rich, interesting structure to say that something interesting happens in them. And this something interesting is going to be that they have a large grid minor. So let me now define what it means to have a large grid minor. So this graph is a grid. So it's a 4x4 grid. I'm going to call it a size 4 grid. So the size of the grid is going to be the size of its side. Now, what it means for this graph to have this graph as a minor, it means you can take this graph, delete some edges, contract some edges, and get this. So there is some sequence of edge deletion, edge contraction operations that will give you this. So as a computer scientist, I actually like to think about this as embedding. You can also think of this as saying that you can embed your grid into your graph. So by embedding, I mean every vertex is embedded as some connected cluster, and these clusters have to be disjoint. And every edge is embedded as some path connecting these clusters. And again, all these paths have to be disjoint and internally disjoint from the clusters. So this is exactly the same as saying that it contains a grid minor, and it's maybe more kind of better to visualize that there is a grid sitting inside. So why is this theorem so useful? One of the reasons it's so useful is that the grid is a very convenient graph. It's very easy to reason about it. It's very easy to prove things about it. It's kind of immediate. And just by knowing that your graph has a large grid minor, there is a lot of things that you can say about your graph. For example, you can say that your graph has many disjoint cycles. Why just look at the grid? It has many disjoint cycles. That's it. So this is kind of question that math people like to look at. You can also show that it contains many disjoint cycles of length 0 modulo m. It's a little bit trickier because when you do contractions, the length is not preserved, but you can also prove that. And a grid is a very convenient routing structure. If you want to solve routing problems, it's really good to know that there is a large grid sitting there. And routing problems to exploit this. You can say that the size of the vertex cover is large just by looking at the grid. Feedback vertex set is large. Look at the grid and many other things. So in fixed parameter tractability, they really like, they just take it and use it. It's really convenient. So because of this, this theorem has been used a lot in fixed parameter tractability and also in math, in Erdős-Porsche type results, in Graf-Meier theory, and so on. So it's a useful theorem. So far I've been vague. I just said, you know, a large grid triwith means a large grid minor. Now I want to be more precise. So we'll say that the triwith is k, then we have a grid minor of size f of k. Again, it's f of k by f of k. And throughout this talk, k is always going to be the triwith. And what we want to know is how big can we make this f of k? Basically, the bigger the grid, the better for us. Knowing that triwith is k, but we only have a grid of size, I don't know, log k, is not that helpful. We really want this grid to be as big as we can. So how far can we even hope to push it? Well, first of all, it's easy to see you'll never be able to push it beyond square root k. Because you can just take a complete graph on n vertices, the triwith is n minus 1. The best you can hope for is root n by root n grid minor, because every vertex of the grid minor uses at least one vertex of the graph. So this really is the limit. Now, you can use a slightly more complicated argument to show that you cannot push it beyond square root k by square root log k. And this is the best negative result that is known today. So this is where the upper bound stands. And Robertson and Seymour conjecture that this is also the right answer, that we should be able to find a grid minor of this size. So let's now see what is known on the positive side. So the original proof of Robertson and Seymour, I'm not sure if it gave explicit bounds, but Robertson, Seymour, and Thomas later showed that f of k can be made as large as log to the 1/5 k. And Distel et al. Later gave a really nice simpler proof of roughly the same bound, a little less. And most recent results, there were two independent works of Kawarabayashi and Kobayashi and of Leaf and Seymour. And they show that you can make the grid minor size as large as root k, root log k by root log k. So as you can see, the best negative result says that you cannot push it beyond roughly root k. And the best positive is roughly root log k. So the question is, can we get polynomial size grid minors? Does it have to be polylogarithmic? Is it anything in between? And in this talk, we show that you can make it polynomial in K. That's the good news. The bad news, the polynomial is still kind of tiny. We are trying to improve it. And I'm sure this will be improved. I wish I could say it will get improved to like square root K, but you know, we are not nearly there yet. And so we not only show this existential result, we also give an efficient algorithm to build the grid minor. And the algorithm is polynomial in both n and k, so we don't assume that k is a constant. And finally, I just want to mention that there are some families of graphs where you can get much better bounds. You can even get grid minor size to be linear in k. For example, planar graphs, bounded genus graphs, and graphs excluding a fixed minor. So from now on, I'm going to focus on this. I'm going to focus on the proof of the grid minor theorem. And I'm going to start by defining one of the main combinatorial objects that we use, which we call the path of set system. So let's see what this path of set system is. I'm using only one parameter, h, to describe it. And this h will eventually be like k to the epsilon. So first of all, we have h disjoint clusters. And when I'm saying a cluster here, it's a connected subgraph of our graph. So we have c1, c2, c3, through ch, and they're ordered in this way. And then every consecutive pair of these clusters, we have h disjoint paths connecting them. And this collection of h paths connecting, let's say, c1 to c2, I'm going to call it a bundle. So we have a bundle for these two, a bundle for these two, and so on. So they're really connected in this order.
Are those connections disjoint from the other?
And we require that all these blue paths are completely disjoint from each other. And they must be internally disjoint from clusters, meaning that each blue path starts at the cluster, ends at the cluster. It cannot contain any other vertices that belong to any cluster.
So it's somewhat weaker. It's one direction of the grid minor. It's only, like, if you could also break it vertically, then.
Yes, right.
So
yes.
It's on the way.
Yes, right.
So you need to establish the existence of this, because if you have a grid minor, then you have this.
Yes, right. Okay, so they really look like this picture. And there is one more requirement, one more constraint in order for this to be a valid path of set system. I need to say that I use this parameter h twice, once for the number of clusters and once for the number of paths in every bundle. And one more extra requirement, if we look at any one of these clusters ci, we look how these blue paths enter and leave ci. These vertices that this cluster shares with the blue paths, we call them interface vertices of this cluster. And the one requirement is that the interface vertices have to be well linked inside CI. And again, what it means is if I take any two equal size subsets of these interface vertices, I can always connect them by disjoint paths. For example, I can take the vertices on the left and the vertices on the right, and I can connect them by disjoint paths if I want to. Of course, the picture doesn't have to be this nice. We have no control over the order of the connection, but we can always rearrange it so it will look this nice. And of course, I can go and do this for every single cluster, and I'll get something like that. Maybe I'll throw out the first and the last cluster. But this is not the only reason why I want this wool linkedness property. Later, I may decide I don't like this, I want to change my mind, and instead I want to connect a different subset of vertices on the left to the vertices on the right. And I can still do it because of this wool linkedness property. So this is something we can use later, but it's not important right now. So right now, this is a really nice picture. And actually, you can see that we are already on the way there because we already have this horizontal path. Yes?
So this is a grid.
Huh?
This becomes a grid.
No. We'll see.
So vertical path.
In a minute, you'll see why this is not a grid, OK? This is going to be really in the next couple of slides. Yes? No, just a pair of subsets. I wish. Okay. So Leaf and Seymour show that given a path of set system with this parameter h, you can find a grid minor of size square root h. So from here, all you need to show is that given a graph of Tribbets k, you can build a path of the system where this H is polynomial in K.
They defined it.
I want to say something about this. Yeah, so what really happened was that Chandra and I, we proved this. We were about to publish our paper, and we said, okay, we'll just, you know, go to Seymour's webpage and check it. And we found there a paper, they did it like a year before us, and they proved this. So they don't start with a path of set system, they start with an object that they call grill. And this is an object that is closely related, but it's weaker than a path of set system. So a path of set system is a grill. From a grill, you can get a path of set system, but you lose a polynomial factor on the number of clusters. Now, because they start from a grill and not from a path of set system, they get something weaker here. They don't get root h, maybe h to the 1/3, h to the 1/4, I'm not sure. But because we start with a stronger object, we get a little better. We get square root h. And now, eventually, you have to show that one of these guys is in our, exists in our graph. And you would think that, you know, grills are weaker objects, they're easier to find. But the way our algorithm works, it just finds this object right away. It doesn't help us to weaken it and get a grill first. So because of this, and because we get a little better, and because the paper was already written, we just stayed with this.
So you're going to say anything about the proof of this?
Yes. So I'm actually, so I actually have two versions of this talk. One mostly does this, and one mostly does this. So I will today do mostly this, because this is very technical. And this is really a nice and intuitive proof, so I want to show this, and I will show you main ideas from here. So I'm going to show you how to get from a path of set system to a grid. So intuition, we want to build a grid. What's a grid? We have a bunch of horizontal paths, the rows of the grid, and we have the columns of the grid. And normally, a column of the grid is a vertical path, right? But I'm going to relax it, and I'll say a thing like that is a column, as far as I'm concerned. And this could be second column, third column, and so on. So what I'm saying is that if I can show that this is a subgraph of my graph, or a minor of my graph, or whatever, then I can get a grid minor. Because I'm allowed to contract edges, right? I can take these green edges, contract them, first column. These green edges, contract them, second column, and so on. So as long as I can show that this is a subgraph of my graph, or a minor of my graph, I'll be fine. So what I'm going to show is I'm going to find a subdivision of this graph, so each one of these edges will actually be a path inside my graph. Now, what does it have to do with a path of set system? Very conveniently, we already have this horizontal path. So all we need is to find this vertical path connecting them. And now, a simple idea would be we'll just take this vertical path one by one and find one in each cluster separately. So this first one, we want to find it in C1, this one in C2, this one in C3, and so on. So it may look easy, because, you know, this cluster is connected. But it actually isn't. Because, for example, in C1, we want to connect P1 to P2. But we have to connect it directly. We need a path that goes from P1 to P2. It cannot stop anywhere. If a path goes first to P3 and comes back to P2, it's not going to work. So a path like that that goes directly is good. It doesn't intersect any other horizontal path. A path like that is not good. It's not going to work for us.
But you can reverse locally the ordering of one.
Yes. Okay, so eventually what we want to happen is that for each one of the CIs, we'll want to take a pair of consecutive paths that we choose, and we want to be able to connect them directly inside that CI. So it's not clear why we should be able to do this, but we do have a lot of freedom. Yeah?
Why do we have to connect just one pair in each cluster?
Oh, because we just have so many clusters. You have one cluster per each one of these. You have even much more. You just want to find this, right? This subgraph. If you find this as a subgraph of your graph, you'll get a grid.
Oh.
And you just do one by one. And the number of clusters is so large that you just can afford to use one cluster per. You can even afford more.
So you need the number of clusters to be bigger. Here you have the number of paths, the number of clusters.
Yes, h. But I'm only shooting for like root h. Actually, this proof that I'm showing is like h to the 1/4. There is a little more complicated proof that gives you square root h, but this is like a very intuitive proof, so I decided to go with this. So we will
so
only
you use each cluster to find a single column.
No. He's saying what he's saying is right. So my grid is h to the 1/4 on h to the 1/4. So a column is only h to the 1/4 of these guys. And I will use h to the 1/4 different clusters to find one column, yeah. Okay?
Sorry, I'm confused. So if you use these h, so you will find one column and h horizontal?
Yeah, I will find one column here. One edge here, one edge here, one edge here.
What's confusing is that this, the number of rows should be smaller for this to make
sense. Oh, yeah.
So
yeah, this is what. Yeah. The grid is not going to be h by h. It's going to be h to the 1/4 by h to the 1/4. Yeah, this is what I was going to say next. So we have a lot of freedom because we don't. Yeah, so we have a lot of freedom. First of all, we don't have to use all these path horizontal ones. We only want to use h to the 1/4 of them. We are also free to use the ordering as long as this ordering is fixed throughout. We're also free to discard many of these clusters. We just need to collect enough of them. So all this helps, as we're going to see. So as I said, inside each one of the clusters, we'll try to connect some pair of horizontal paths directly. So we need to look inside the cluster and understand what it looks like. So let's say that this is my cluster. This is what it looks like inside. Now, what I really care about is I want to look at these horizontal paths, and I want to know which ones of them I can connect directly without stopping at another path. So it's very reasonable thing to do to represent it by a graph. I will have a vertex for each one of these horizontal paths, and I'll connect a pair of vertices with an edge if and only if we can connect them by a direct path in this graph. For example, P1 and P2, you can connect them directly through this red edge, so I put an edge there. P1 and P3, we can connect them by this path directly, I put an edge here. P1 and P4, there is no way to connect them, so I don't put an edge. So I build a graph like that. And you know, it can look in whatever way it will look, but it's connected. And now, the really, really good scenario that I'm hoping for is that this graph will have this path. It goes P1, P2, P3, P4. If this happens, and this happens for a large enough number of clusters, then this is it. We're happy.
You cannot hope that this will happen in one single cluster.
I know. That's why it's not trivial. Yeah, so let's see. So the good scenario would be, like the perfect scenario, each one of the clusters, the corresponding graph contains this one path, and things are perfect. And again, it doesn't have to be a path that spans all the vertices, all the horizontal paths. It's enough that it spans enough of them. It doesn't have to be this ordering. We can choose the ordering, but it has to be the same ordering. And it doesn't have to be all the clusters. We just want enough clusters. But you know, this doesn't have to happen. What's the best scenario? Well, one best scenario is the ordering is going to be different. But another thing that you may be worried about, what if it doesn't have a long path? What if, you know, we just get a star? So this looks really pretty bad, but actually this is not bad. It's actually a pretty good case, because remember that we are allowed to throw out horizontal paths. So if I decide to throw out P1, then every pair of these guys cannot connect directly. So if P1 stops being my horizontal path, this is like perfect. Every pair can go directly. So we are going to exploit this. So let's look again at this graph, and again, we're going to try and understand it. And there is a really nice theorem with a really nice proof by Leaf and Seymour. It's really not very difficult. And it just shows that, let's say we have any graph that has n vertices, then one of two things has to happen. Either you can build a tree in this graph that has a very large number of leaves, square root n leaves. Or there is a long path in this graph, which is a two-path. A two-path means that every one of the inner vertices, its degree in the graph is only 2. So it's really induced path. There are no other neighbors of this vertex in the graph. So either there is a tree with square root n leaves, or a two paths of length square root n. And actually, that tree is a spanning tree, but it's not going to matter. So it's not a very difficult theorem. It's really nice, but I don't have time to show everything, so I will skip this. So, yeah? Mm-hmm.
So even if you have indirect paths, or direct paths from P1 to P2, between P2 and P4, those paths may share vertices.
Yes. That's why you only take one edge from each one of them.
Oh.
That's why you, yeah. That's why you don't try to route the whole column inside this guy, only one edge. Yeah. It's true. Yeah, so these paths, all of them may share the same vertex for all we know.
But then you have a different graph for every cluster.
Right. Yes. That's what we're trying to, that's exactly why it's non-trivial.
In the case, we have the same graph.
Yes. And the same path, yes. But is that this doesn't has to have to happen. A two path is basically an induced path. It means that if you take an inner vertex on this path, its only neighbors in this graph are the two neighbors from the path. So every inner vertex is degree two in the graph. So we can just look at these graphs, right, for every cluster. And each one of these graphs has h vertices. So one of these two things has to happen. Either it has a tree with square root h leaves, or it has two paths of length square root h. So maybe a little counterintuitively, I'll say that this cluster is good if the first thing happens. It has a tree with square root h leaves. So what I'm going to do, I will first assume that we got lucky and all clusters are good. I'm going to show you how to finish the proof. And then we're going to go back and remove this assumption and still finish the proof. So I'll assume that all clusters are good.
All is, you don't need all.
Yeah, 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 but it's not going to matter. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So we'll look at this good cluster. We'll take this spanning tree or tree that has square root h leaves. And I will really care about the leaves of this tree. The special thing about the leaves of this tree is that if eventually, when I choose my horizontal path of the grid, there are going to be the leaves of this tree, then this cluster will be very helpful because any pair of them, it can connect directly without going through other leaves. So I'm going to say that this cluster chooses the square root h path that corresponds to its leaves. And again, if eventually this is going to be the set of horizontal paths, then we can use this cluster to connect them directly. So now let's see, each one of these clusters chooses square root h of the horizontal path. If we get super lucky, all of them will choose the same set of horizontal paths. And then, you know, things are so good, we'll ignore all other paths. And now inside each one of these clusters, any pair of them can be connected directly. You can actually build a clique minor if you want. But, you know, we're only after a grid minor, so we'll just do our plan, I'll do this. Of course, normally, I mean, this is way too optimistic, it's not going to happen, right? Normally, maybe every one of them will choose a different subset of horizontal paths. What do you do now? So in the previous proofs, like Distel et al., what they did is they said, okay, if the number of clusters is really gigantic, then there is some choice that will repeat enough times, and this is what we'll go after. But for this, the number of clusters has to be like at least exponential in h, and we'll never get a polynomial size grid minor. So this is not good for us. So we need to do something different. And here's what we're going to do. We'll only focus on clusters number 1, 3, 5, 7, and so on, odd index clusters. And I'm going to ignore the even index clusters. And now let's look at this.
They will be used for routing the path.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So let's look at this cluster, right? The guy here chose this set of paths, the guy here chose a different set of paths. And we're going to use this guy, because its interface is willing to reconnect them in such a way that it will look like this and this have chosen the same set of paths. So we just extend this path to here, use the fact that this the interface vertices are willing here to find a set of disjoint paths connecting them. And now this cluster and this cluster have chosen the same set of paths. And we just keep doing this for every pair of consecutive odd index clusters. We use the even index cluster in the middle to do this. And now we get what we wanted. We are only reduced to odd index clusters, but any pair of these guys can now be connected inside the odd index clusters directly. We're done. So, so far so good. But we have assumed that each one of these clusters was good. What if this is not the case? So now what I'm going to do, I'll just remove this assumption completely. I don't care which cluster is good, which cluster is not good. I'll just do the whole proof. Now I'm going to do this trick. I will just group these clusters into square root h consecutive clusters, sets of square root h consecutive clusters. I'm going to get square root h of them. And each one of these set of square root h consecutive clusters, I'm going to call it a supercluster. And in our supercluster, you can think of this as a cluster in itself, right? There is nothing wrong with that. So I'm going to show that for each one of these superclusters, either I'll be able to build a large grid miner inside the supercluster, or if I cannot do it, I will show that the supercluster is a good cluster. So if I can build a grid miner even in one of them, this is it, we build the grid miner. But if for every single one of them I cannot build a grid miner, then every single one of them is a good cluster, and we knew how to handle them, and we are done. So all we need to do is for each SI to show that one of these two things happens. And let's do it.
What are the interface vertices for the supercluster?
Same thing. This, right, and this. Like where the blue paths enter and they leave. So this is my supercluster. In this case, it's a union of four clusters. And remember, for each one of these clusters, we have built this graph. It has a vertex for each horizontal path, and an edge if and only if we can connect them directly in this cluster. So now we can look again at this whole thing as a cluster, and we can build the same graph for this whole cluster. There is a vertex for every horizontal path, there is an edge if and only if we can connect them directly in this whole supercluster. And this graph is actually easy to see, it's just a union of these graphs. So again, in this graph, one of two things has to happen. Either it has a tree with square root h leaves, or it has a long two path. So if it has a tree with square root h leaves, we are done. This is a good cluster, we don't need to do anything. So let's say that it has a long two path. So if it has a two path of length square root h, I want to show you how to build the grid miner directly inside the supercluster. And what I really want to do, I want to claim, if this is the two path that belongs to here, I would like to claim that this two path has to appear in every single one of them. If I could do this, then we would have a long path that appears in many clusters, and that would be it. Right? This was exactly our perfect scenario.
Yeah, this would be the vertical one.
Yes. Yes. This one path will define. Yeah. So ideally, I want to show that there is this one path that appears in every single one of them. I show something a little weaker, but as good, almost as good. I will show that there is a very long subpath of this path that appears in at least half of them.
Why do you need the induced?
You'll see in a sec. You'll see in a second. It's important that it's induced. Okay? This is how I can claim that this large path appears in every single one of them. So I want to prove that basically this roughly this path appears in every single one of them. So let's look at the first cluster. And I want to say that this path should appear in it, roughly speaking. So if we look at any vertex of this path, V3, right? Remember that this is an induced path in this graph, and this graph is a union of these guys, right? So this is a subgraph of this graph. So the only possible neighbors for V3 inside this graph are V2 and V4. Nobody else can be its neighbor. But this graph is connected. So it has to contain this whole path, maybe minus one edge. But you cannot delete two edges from this path. If you take this path minus two edges, then this will not be a connected graph anymore. OK? Yes. So the trick here, I want to show that this whole path, maybe minus one edge, belongs to this graph. And this happens because this graph has to be connected. And this is a two path in this graph. And this is a subgraph of this. So for example, if you look at this vertex, its only neighbors in this graph can be V2 and V4, no one else.
This is where you use the fact that it's induced.
Yes, yes. Because otherwise, you know, yes, yes. Right? So if you even take out two edges from this path, there is no way that this graph will be connected. So it has to contain this whole path, maybe minus one edge. And the same is true for every single one of them. So if I just take this path and break it into two in the middle, I get two subpaths, and every single one of them has to contain either the first or the second. So one of these two will have to belong to half of them. What's funny? Yeah, and we get the grid miner. Okay, so we show that for every SI, either it contains a large grid miner or it is a, oh man, good cluster. It's still from like a really old version, type 1 cluster. Or it's a good cluster and then we are done. So this finishes the part where we go from the path of set system to the grid miner. And now I want to say a little bit about how we find this path of set system. So I'm going to kind of take a detour and talk for a short while about something that looks very different about routing problems. But it's really the work on these routing problems that led to this proof. So specifically, let's look at one routing problem, Edge-Gijian path problem. So we have a graph G, and we have a collection of sourcing pairs, S1, T1, S2, T2, so on through SK, TK. And you can think of it as if we want to connect, I don't know, this my computer just moves on its own. You can think of it as if you want to connect SI to TI with a path. So you want a path connecting these pairs. For every pair, you want to find a path. But you want this path to be edge disjoint. So an edge may appear in at most one of these paths. So under these constraints, it's clear that you may not be able to route all of them, so you want to route as many as you can. So this is edge disjoint, and in node disjoint, you want them to be vertex disjoint. So when k is a constant, then this is solvable. Robertson and Seymour showed them also as part of their graph miner theory. So when k is 2, there is a really neat theorem that proves this, shows the solution. It's like, I found it pretty amazing, the statement of this theorem, but anyway, the moment. There's actually like three or four different groups of people who did, yeah. It basically says that either you can route them or your graph is planar and these guys are switched on the boundary of this planar graph. It's quite amazing, I think. But the moment you go to k equals to 3, you have to go through this really difficult and long proof where you have to go through the grid miner theorem and through many different things. So it's like several papers to prove this whole thing. This is quite amazing. Like, just 3 pairs, we don't have a simple algorithm. But anyway, this is one connection to the grid miner theorem, and there is going to be another one. In general, when k can be large, this problem is NP-hard. And recently, oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So these SITI guys, I'm going to call them terminals, and let's assume that they're all distinct. And I'm going to define one special case of this problem that's going to be useful. It's called a well-linked instance. So we say that an instance is well-linked if, when we look at the set of terminals, they are well-linked in our graph. So why this instance was so useful? It was shown by Chakuri, Khan, and Shepherd quite a while ago that, roughly speaking, if you're looking for an approximation algorithm, it is enough for you to find an approximation algorithm for well-linked instances, and you get right away automatically an approximation algorithm for the whole thing. So I'm cheating a little. Here, there are some technical details that I don't want to mention, but roughly speaking, this is what they showed. And so because of this, most of the work was focused on trying to find good algorithms for well-linked instances. And there has been quite a bit of progress recently on these algorithms. And so today, we can show a polylocal approximation if we allow up to 2 edges, each edge to be shared by up to 2 paths. And for node disjoint paths, you can show polylocal approximation if you allow up to some constant number of paths to share a vertex. So the reason I'm mentioning all this is that all these results, they use some structural result that seems very relevant to what we're doing. So let me show you what is the structural result. First at a very, very high level, and then we'll get into a little bit more detail. Basically, they start with a well-linked instance. They show that if the instance is well-linked, then your graph has some nice routing structure that they call a large crossbar, that I'm going to tell you what it is. And then they just use this routing structure, this large crossbar, to find the routing. So why is this relevant? It's relevant because of this connection between well-linkedness and truids. So if your instance is well-linked, then you have a set of k vertices that are well-linked. Then you know that your truid is at least k. But also, if you have a large graph with a large truid, you know that it contains a set of vertices that is also well-linked, a large set of vertices. And there is an efficient algorithm to find an almost a set of size almost k, k over square root log k, but you can find it. So if you get a graph with a large tree, it's you can pretend that you're given a good instance for this adjacent path problem, a well-linked instance, and then you can hope that you can build on this machinery and to get something useful. And now again, why we do this, and the reason is that the way this crossbar looks like is really kind of in the right direction to what we need to find. It's really kind of close to this path of set system. And this is really was our starting point, and then we had to hammer it more to get all the way to the path of set system. So let me show you what this crossbar is. And I'm going to only show you how it's different from what we want from the path of set system. So this is what we want, the path of set system, and I'm going to list the differences because it's really like a path of set system. So the first difference is that we want polynomial number of clusters. We want k to the epsilon clusters. And this construction only gives like log square k clusters. So this seems like a problem, but really, this construction is very general. You change the parameters, it still works. It just happened that for that one, we only needed log square k, but you can get poly k if you want to. So this was really not an issue, just redo the whole thing with different parameters. The second issue, and this is where almost all the technical work goes into, is that we have very strict disjointness requirements. We really need all these blue paths to be totally disjoint from each other and internally disjoint from the clusters. What these algorithms gave us in the best case was that an edge may belong up to maybe two of these blue paths, or maybe one path and one cluster. So this feels like it goes in the right direction, but it's not what we really need. So this was like where we really had to work hard. And there is, so I'm not going to show this part. There is one third barrier that we were really stuck at it for a very long time and we didn't know how to get around this, but I'm going to show you it has a really simple way to get around it. So the third issue was that what we need is these clusters organized into a path. And what this construction gives us is this path organized into a tree. So it gives us a tree where the maximum vertex degree is at most three. So it feels like we are so close, right? Here the maximum vertex degree is two, here the maximum vertex degree is three. We should be able to go from here to here. It took us a while to figure out how. So this is the part that I'm going to show you, how to get from a tree to the path. Yeah, so I'm going to define this thing formally, and I'm going to show how to get from here to here. Yeah. So I'm going to define this path of set system, and then I'm going to show you how, tree of set system, and then I'm going to show how to get from the tree to the path. So a tree of set system is basically exactly like the path of set system, only it's a tree with maximum vertex degree at most three. So we start with a tree with a maximum vertex degree at most three, and every vertex of this tree has to be a cluster. Again, a connected subgraph for a graph, and all these clusters are disjoint. Every edge of this tree is actually a bundle of H paths connecting these two clusters. And again, all these blue paths, they have to be disjoint from each other and internally disjoint from the clusters.
Why can't you do this at depth of
cell? Yes, it's exactly the next slide. Give me a second, okay? that's like the first attempt to do it. Okay, and one extra thing is before we have these well-linkedness requirements, so if we look at any cluster, then its interface has to be well-linked. And this time, the interface comes from three sides, right? At most three sides. So all the vertices that this cluster shares with the blue paths, they have to be well-linked inside the cluster. And again, H is both the number of clusters and the number of paths in every bundle, and again, it's going to be about k to the epsilon. So we start with this tree, and we want to turn it into a path. H to the one third. So the first simple thing to observe is that if the height of this tree is h to the one third, then this is it. We just get the root two leaf paths, and this is our path of set system. We're done. Good. If this is not the case, if the height is less than that, then we know that this tree has to have many leaves, because every vertex of the tree has to lie on some root two leaf paths. If we have few, the height is not too big, then we have to have many leaves. So actually, the number of leaves is going to be h to the 2/3, but I only want h to the 1/3 size path, so I will only care about h to the 1/3. And I want to build a path with that system on a subset of this h to the 1/3 leaves, and these leaves are going to be my clusters. So I'm going to assume for simplicity that the tree has exactly h to the 1/3 leaves. If it has more, I'm going to throw them out. It looks like a strange thing to do, but I want the separation between the number of leaves, which is h to the 1/3, and the number of paths in every bundle, which is h. We'll see why we need it. So as Ivy has suggested, this is our tree, and you know we want a path with that system over the leaves. So the most natural thing in the world would be just do a DFS search, right? Just do a tour of this tree like that, and use this tour to turn this thing into a path. But we should remember that for every edge of this path, we really want to route many paths simultaneously. So to go from here to here, we need to a large set of paths going from here to here. To go from here to here, we want a large set of paths going all the way here, and so on. And we already have these bundles, right? So it looks like it should be doable, right?
Just an internal connectivity.
Yes. But we need to figure out what to do inside the clusters. So if we take a cluster whose degree is 3, we may need to route 3 sets of paths in it. The paths that come from the parent go to the first child, the paths that come from the first child go to the second child, and from the second child back up. So we have this well-linkedness property. The interface vertices are well-linked inside this cluster. This allows us to route 1 set of paths. Actually, in this case, we can even route 2 sets of paths because they have the same destination. So you can kind of set up a single source, single sink kind of a thing and route even 2 of these paths, these sets. But because we need to route 3 of these sets, this is something that well-linkedness simply does not give us. And this was really frustrating because you're really kind of almost there, but it just doesn't work. So now I'm going to show you a way to get around it, and it's actually going to be quite simple. So we're going to do 2 steps. In the first step, we're going to build for each one of the leaves a large set of paths connecting it to the root. And all these paths, they will follow the tree, and they will be completely disjoint. And then in the second iteration, in the second stage, I'm going to use this path to somehow stitch this whole thing into one path of set system. So the first iteration is pretty easy. I only have h to the 1/3 leaves. I want to connect every leaf by many paths to the root. So I'm just going to start from the top, and I will slowly grow this path until they reach the leaves. For example, this guy has h paths here, h paths here. Let's just take them. Now, when we reach any one of these clusters, we may need to split the flow that comes from its parent between the two children. So now I use the word flow, but it's really integral flow, it's path. So for example, here, maybe this guy receives 4 flow units from its parent, and we need to split it between the children. So we're going to choose 2 vertices on the left, 2 vertices on the right. And now we have 4 red vertices, 4 green vertices. Because the interface is well linked, we can connect them by disjoint paths. And we have split the flow. So in this case, we split the flow 50-50 because each one of the children has the same number of leaves in its subtree. If, for example, this one had 1 leaf, this one had 10 leaves, we would split it 1 to 10, but exactly the same idea. So you just keep on doing this simple thing until you reach the leaves. And in the end, you can see that each one of the leaves will receive roughly the same amount of flow, which is going to be roughly h to the 2/3. So this finishes the first stage. And now in the second stage, we start with these green paths. And I'm going to exploit them to build the tree of set system, the path set system. So this time, I'm going to go bottom up through this tree and slowly build it. And I'm going first to show you what is the invariant that we're going to preserve throughout this algorithm. So here is the invariant. Let's say that we have just finished processing this cluster. The invariant is that at this point of time, we should finish constructing a path of set system spanning all the leaves in its subtree. And in this path of set system, we're only allowed to use the edges in the vertices. It's supposed to be this green area inside here in the subtree of this cluster. And one extra thing, if we look at the first and the last cluster here, and we look at the green paths that used to connect these two clusters to the root, then many of these green paths still survived in the sense that they're disjoint from this path of set system. For each one of these paths, the first vertex belongs to A or to B, but otherwise they have to be disjoint from this thing. So again, it doesn't have to happen to every single one green path that we have computed before, but many of them still have this property. And we think of them as surviving paths. So if we manage to do this until we reach the root vertex, then clearly we'll get a path of set system spanning all the leaves, and this will be it. So we just need to see how we can run this whole thing and preserve this invariant. So we go bottom up, and we start maybe with some leaf. We need to build a path of set system spanning this leaf. This is just this leaf. There is nothing to do. So a more interesting thing is what happens when we reach some vertex that has degree 3. So let's say that this is some cluster that has two children that we want to process now. This is the root. And because we now try to process this cluster, we have finished processing its two children. So we have finished building these two path of set systems spanning the leaves in each one of the two subtrees. And all we want to do is stitch them somehow together. And we said that if we look at A and B, then many of the green paths connecting them to the root still survive. They're disjoint from this. And same happens there. So we want to somehow exploit these green paths and this cluster to stitch these two together. So for each one of these green paths, we look at the first time where this path hits this cluster X. And this is just the big picture of this cluster X. So now we want to find H to the 1/3 paths connecting the vertices on the left to the vertices on the right, disjoint paths. And of course, we can find them because, again, the interface is well linked. But we want one extra property. We want to make sure that these blue paths, they intersect only H to the 1/3 of the green paths here and only H to the 1/3 of the green paths here. So this is a little trickier to show, but it's still doable. So the idea is going to be that first we'll make sure that they intersect only a small number of green paths here by rerouting them somehow, and then we do it on the right. So just a high-level idea, if some blue path hits a green path, it can just turn and follow it, right? And you can think about this as if we're trying to find some kind of a matching between blue paths and green paths so that they will hit them and then turn. Now, you can set up a stable marriage problem here in a clever way, in such a way that if they do it and turn, then things will not intersect, you'll get disjoint paths. So you set up a stable marriage problem on the left, a stable marriage problem on the right, to do rerouting twice, and this just works. So this, I'm not going to go into more detail. So let's say that we get H to the 1/3 blue paths, and they only intersect a small number of green paths on each side. So now these blue paths, they connect these vertices on the left to the vertices on the right. So it's vertices from A prime and B prime to vertices of C prime and D prime. So at least a quarter of them connects one of these two to one of these two. Let's say that it's B prime to C prime. So now we just use the prefixes of this green path together with the blue path to stitch this whole path of set system together. And we throw out the green paths that intersect this blue path. Again, their number is only going to be H to 1/3. And all we need to do is to make sure that this math just works out, that we can keep on going until we reach the root. And this is because at the beginning, each one of these sets had H to the 2/3 paths. In every iteration, we throw out H to the 1/3 of them, but the height of the tree is only H to the 1/3. So we have enough paths. Even until we reach the root, we can still have paths. So that's the whole thing. So that's the whole scheme of this whole proof. Basically, there are three parts. The first, going from path of set system to a grid miner, which we have seen. The second, showing that you can find a tree of set system from a large tree width graph. And the third, going from a tree of set system to a path of set system, which we have just seen. So most of the technical work really goes into here, and this is where we lose most in this exponent. But luckily, because we worked so hard, we get an extra thing from here. We can get a polylocal approximation for node disjoint paths with congestion too. And this beats all these previous results because node disjoint paths is more general than edge disjoint paths. And for no degen paths, this result only gave a constant congestion and not two, which is probably optimal. So to summarize, this shows the first polynomial relationship between Chiwetz and grid minor size. The polynomial is still tiny. The epsilon is 1 over 98. Hopefully, it will be improved, hopefully all the way to square root k, but we are still not near this. And what I'm really interested in is trying to build better and simpler constructions of the path of set system and tree of set systems, because they are interesting both for the grid minor theorem and for routing problems. They seem to be central objects for both of these things. So I think they're interesting, and right now the proof of this part is quite a mess. It has many steps. So getting nice, simple proof constructions of these two would be really interesting. And that's all, thank you. The degree of the polynomial?
Yes,
I have no idea. It's probably big. Yes. I don't think so, because what you can show that if you have a graph of Chiwetz k, it has a subgraph of size k square. And same tree widths, roughly. Maybe k over polylog k. So it doesn't help you to.
So the best lower bound is always for a graph of size k square.
Yes. Actually, if the graph is size is less than k square and tree widths is k, you can show that it has a click minor pretty easily. Yes. Yeah, it's very easy. You just take an expander, a constant degree expander. So the Chiwetz is omega of n. But if you look at the grid, it has many degen cycles. In expander, every cycle has, you need an expander whose Gauss is at least log n. So each one of the cycles has to use up to log n vertices from your expander. And so you get to root k by root log k.
Okay.